Hello, fishing friends. Welcome to another episode of The Fishing Podcast. I'm your host, Landon DeKaiser, and this is where I interview industry greats, average Joes and Janes, biologists, conservationists, and everything in between. My goal is simple. I want to inspire anglers to catch more fish, more places, more often. All right, welcome back to the Fishing Podcast, everybody. Appreciate you joining in today. And as the forecast has been looking a little bit warmer here in the near future, actually much warmer, I think I actually saw a day up near 80 next week here in mid-Michigan. So I'm excited about that because warm weather means good smallmouth fishing. I've been out a few times trying to get some smallmouth, but it's been slow. I've gotten a few, gotten some decent fish, but nothing crazy. However, with these warmer temps, the water temperatures might finally get out of the 40s, where they've been for, I don't know, 2 or 3 months, into that temperature range where the smallmouth are a little bit more active and a little bit easier to catch. And that's what I like about smallmouth is they are a little bit easier to catch. You know, I spend a lot of time chasing steelhead and being frustrated and wondering why the heck they're not biting. And you know, the same goes for trout some days. You know, some of my favorite trout rivers I go in, there's just nothing there. It seems like all the fish have just somehow disappeared. Smallmouth are not that way in my experience. Once really like June hits, June through August, September, that's when I love to be on the river smallmouth fishing. And our guest today is John Gouker, and he has been guiding for many years and does a pretty good amount of smallmouth guiding, as well as salmon and steelhead and trout, even some pike fishing. So we cover a lot of those other species briefly at the beginning of the episode, but I'd say a bulk of probably a good 50 minutes to an hour of today's episode is really focused on catching smallmouth. And John guides exclusively fly fishing trips for smallmouth, but so much of this information, if you're not into fly fishing, you don't have a fly rod, this is still important information. I learned a lot from John on this episode just about smallmouth and catching smallmouth and different presentations, and all that can be transferred. You know, it doesn't matter if you're talking about fly fishing or spin fishing, you can definitely transfer that information from one style of fishing to the other. So if you live in Michigan and you don't go smallmouth fishing in the summertime, you're really, really missing out because, you know, you can be floating down the river in a raft or a kayak in your swim trunks with your shoes off, drinking a beer, and just really enjoying life. You know, our summers here in Michigan are so great and our winters can be so bleak. You got to get out there and enjoy the good weather while we have it. And it's coming, guys and girls. It's coming. We're getting some warm weather. Next week, it's already warmed up a few degrees. Finally, spring feels like it's here now that we're halfway through May. And hopefully those smallmouth are getting excited about it too. So, yeah, that's it. That's what it's about. Smallie fishing, boys and girls. So, here we go. Hey, John, how's it going today?
Going great. Glad to be on with you.
Yeah, thanks for joining me. I appreciate you. Appreciate you jumping on. I guess you probably don't have a normal work schedule since you're a guide, so it's not really after work for you. It's just you're not working right now.
Just not working right now. That's exactly it. The schedule is a little all over the place sometimes.
So. Yeah. So, at the beginning, I always just like to let my guests introduce themselves, who they are, where they're from, what they do for a living, and all that fun stuff.
Perfect. So my name is John Gouker. I am the owner and guide scout for Gouker Fly Fishing. I've been a guide for 17 years. I previously guided for Schmidt Outfitters for a long time, for Ray Schmidt.
Okay.
And I've been, you know, living up in this area, Manistee area, for almost 20, and fishing up in this area, Northern Michigan, for about 25 years.
Nice.
So quite a while. So yeah. So I love being up here. It's a great place to be, great place to fish, and great place to live. So
yeah, you're really in the prime of Michigan, for, or what I would consider the prime of Michigan. It's got everything you want up there. Lots of peace and quiet, and lots of fishing, good hunting, pretty much anything outdoors you want to do in Michigan's right there. Ski hills, you name it.
Yeah, it is. It's a great place with we've got a massive amount of water, from still water to small streams to bigger rivers, warm water species, cold water species. It's kind of one of those places to really be fortunate to live in. So, especially for me as a full time fly fishing guide, it's ideal. I don't have to actually travel around to different areas to work. I can actually work here, year round, and make a living on it, which is fantastic.
Yeah. So what all species do you guide for again?
So for my species that I target smallmouth bass, trout, steelhead, and I do a little bit of salmon dive.
Okay.
And I do a little bit of more of the toothy critter stuff too. I do some stuff with pike. But that kind of mixes right in with some of my smallmouth stuff too. So,
is the pike fishing, is that on the rivers as well, or do you fish in some of the lakes up there?
So that can be both. So the river can be, the Manistee can be a pretty good pike fishery, and then some of the smaller lakes, the reservoirs also are pretty good pike fishing too. So,
okay.
I actually frequently carry especially early in the season, like that May, June period for smallmouth, and then later in the season, if somebody's interested, I typically throw a pike rod or two in the boat and they can do some of that. So it's kind of nice to have if they're kind of on the feed. So,
yeah. I don't want to spend too much time on it because I want to get more into smallmouth, but just
sure.
Because I'm curious, what might you be looking for in a river for pike? Where are the pike going to be living at if you're actually targeting them?
It's interesting. They kind of cohabitate quite well with smallmouth when I'm fishing for them. But, the places that seem to really lock them in, if you have any creek dumping into the rivers, bayous, any soft, slow corners, things like that, that seems to be a pretty prime locale to find pike. That seems to, you can turn them. I've caught them in really fast water. But for the most part, they seem to like that little bit slower water.
Gotcha.
So,
yeah, that's kind of what I figured. I've never targeted pike in rivers. I've caught plenty of them in the rivers. Well, usually I don't catch them. I just set the hook and there's nothing there anymore. Smallmouth fishing.
That happens frequently. Yeah. 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 There are days when I'm doing that, and I always carry some light, knotable wire with me, because sometimes it's good, even if I'm traveling around somewhere and I'm on a river I don't know, the bass will still eat on that lighter knotable wire. But, after you've lost, half a dozen flies you spend a lot of time tying or purchased, it's good insurance not to have them, nipped off on that, in a few casts.
Yeah. Yeah. That's not a bad idea. So when you say knotable wire, is that just wire that you can actually tie like fishing line? Are you still with me, John? Uh-oh. I think we lost him.
Hey, I don't know if it was my phone or what, but it dropped.
No, no worries. Yeah, I don't know. I wasn't paying attention to what happened on the computer. It just wasn't on the call anymore. Not a big deal.
Yeah, we've got some storms rolling through here and some rain. I don't know if it's going to cause some issues or not with the phone reception, but I'm at the best spot I can find for reception here in the house. So.
Yeah, no worries. If it cuts out again, we'll reconnect, and if it gets too bad, we can always finish it up another day. Not a big deal.
Okay, perfect.
But I don't know if you heard my question or not. You said knotable wire. Could you kind of explain what that is? Because I'm honestly not entirely sure.
Sure. So for some of these toothy fish, pike and musky. There's a lot of different products out there, but they make some knotable wire, and they make it from a lot of the times from, like, you know, 10-pound knotable wire up to, you know, for shark, I mean, really heavy stuff, 20, 30, 40 pounds, pretty common for, like, you know, pike and musky stuff.
Okay.
But, so basically even in the lighter stuff where I'm using, where I'm fishing bass for insurance sometimes, there's a lot of pike. It, basically you can tie the normal notch you're tying, for monofilament or fluorocarbon. You can use those same knots with this wire, and it just keeps those sharp teeth from cutting through.
Right.
So it just keeps you connected with, you know, that it seems like, you know, you can scale up the heavier mono, but if you start getting the bigger fish, bigger, you know, with teeth, they tend to, eventually, you know, if they hit it right, they bite it right off, or they eventually wear through it when you're fighting them. So
yeah,
some of that lighter stuff works well. I don't use it if I don't have to, but if there's times where you have to, I will. And it seems like even with that light stuff, the smallmouth will still respond to flies okay.
That's good to know.
Sorry,
fishing in the Grand, it's not uncommon to get bit off, you know, 2 to 5 times in an afternoon of fishing. And
right.
And I'm always wondering, what did I miss out on? You know, was it a 40-inch pike? Was it, you know, maybe it was a little dinker, but it's that question of what was that fish and could I have caught it if I would have done something different? But I've never used that knotable wire when I have pike fished in the past. I've used like the pre-made steel leaders, but those are pretty bulky. So I'll have to pick some of that up.
Yeah, it comes in, you know, you can get it from multiple manufacturers, but it comes in like a, you know, if you don't need a ton of it, just a normal tippet size spool it'll be on, and it'll have, depending on the company, 15 feet, 20 feet of it on there, which, you know, you're only putting, for most of your pike stuff, you're putting a foot,
okay,
you know, on there, you know, not a ton. So, you know, just trying to keep it a little bit away from the teeth. So,
Is there any specific brands that you like, or do they all pretty much work?
I'm trying to think of what the Rio, their knotable stuff is pretty good. I think Tiger Wire was another brand of it. I've tried a bunch of different. They're some pretty similar stuff, but like I said, they're very, very easy to work with. You can knot them on, you know, very, very easily. It's, and you know, like to tie any knot you normally, if you want to tie a clinch knot or you're tying a non-slip mono loop or anything like that, you can, you know, you can certainly use that kind of light wire for it.
Nice. Okay. So you said you do a little bit of salmon fishing too. I imagine that's
a little bit.
As far as kings go, probably getting wrapped up there, or is there still some fish moving into the river?
We still have fish moving into the river. So, you know, I typically, you know, might do some streamer trips early. Now we're at the end of September. And luckily, you know, on the big manatee, we typically have steelhead starting to kind of show up in later September. Mm-hmm. So I'm doing, you know, I'm, you know, fishing runs, and there are salmon, you know, getting hooked on occasion, but I'm, you know, mostly looking for steelhead this time of year if I'm on the big water.
Gotcha.
So.
And then I imagine you're doing some brown trout fishing still this time of year as well.
Yeah, so I do. September is actually probably my favorite month for one of my favorite months on the Pine. I guide on the Pine, and that's a great river for September. Once you get past Labor Day, the canoe traffic kind of fades away, and you know, it stays open till the end of September, so you can get some really good quality, fishing in there. This year has been a little difficult with the rain. We just kind of had that big rain Sunday, so it blew the river out. It's kind of water sensitive to that. So, that can be a great, you know, great, great fishery in the September timeframe. And it's nice to kind of get away from, the boat crowds there on the bigger, like the big Manistee, where it gets weekends can get a little crowded on the, you know, when there's salmon around in the river. So.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. When you're fishing for browns this time of year, do you do anything different than you would throughout, say, the summer or spring? Are you looking for different areas?
You know, the areas aren't changing much. There's not been a significant change in water temperature in there. You know, you're still starting in the 50s in the morning. You might get into low 60s during the day, but it really ends up, I guess I would say the biggest change for me, you know, July, August, I'm spending a little more time, you know, switching between streamer fishing and throwing like terrestrial. Mm-hmm. And as it gets later into September, the terrestrials start kind of fading out a little bit more, and the water temps staying more in the 50s, you know, throughout the day, you know, it becomes a really good time of year to do some streamer fishing on it. So the fish are typically, you know, it's right in that kind of sweet spot temperature wise, and the fish are kind of feeding up, and it's a good, and I love streamer fishing, so that kind of fits perfectly for me. I like the visual aspect of that too, and the ferocious takes, and you start losing a little bit of the sun angles start changing, so you tend to keep a little more shade on the river at, you know, later in the day, and so you get some shots at some, it seems like some bigger fish start coming out and playing a little bit more as it gets into, you know, September. So
yeah, I wish that I, throughout the years, have done more fishing in the fall. Usually I'm sitting in a tree stand, but I'm planning to get out and trying to do some more brown trout, specifically fishing this fall. So that's kind of why I was asking, wondering if there's anything different I should be looking for, since I honestly don't have a ton of experience fishing in the October, November months.
Yeah. You know, as it gets later into the fall, you know, we obviously lose our opportunities at dry fly fishing. You know, nymph fishing obviously is a, you know, can be a year round proposition. I personally, you know, I do enough nymph fishing for steelhead that, when I have opportunities with like brown trout where, I can get, you know, fish coming out and chasing bigger streamers and eating that type of thing and see the takes. I definitely have a tendency to streamer fish in fall. Fall typically, you know, one of those, you know, once you get into September, October, November, even into December when we have, you know, some of these warmer falls like we've been having, the streamer fishing for, you know, brown trout can be excellent.
Yeah. Is water clarity as important in the fall with the colder temperatures, you know, in the summertime when I'm streamer fishing, or in the springtime, I'm always looking for high, dirty water. Does that remain the same?
You know, a little bit of off colored water is okay. You know, I definitely don't have any fears of that. Like I fished the Little Manistee a lot, and, you know, and that I always hope for rain and it holds the water well. And I like that nice, when it gets that really good key stain to it, the fish seem to prowl around a lot more. The bigger waters though, like say the Big Manistee, I mean, a little stain helps, but, you know, you've got enough water, and typically as we get into fall, you know, we have a lot less light and we tend to have a lot more of these, you know, dreary overcast days, which, typically, you know, bode well for the fishing. So sometimes, even with really clear water, if we have those overcast days like that and the light's low, the fish are still pretty happy and willing to chase. And I think they know winter's around the corner, and, you know, putting the food bag on is, you know, a essential thing for them. So,
right.
And then, you know, later in the, you know, in those big browns later in the year after they've gone through their spawn, you know, they're trying to put some weight back on before winter really sets in. So.
Yeah. Do you use any different size flies in the fall than you normally would, or stick to same size for deer? How do you typically select a size of a streamer for browns?
So for brown trout, if it's not a match the hatch situation, which we kind of run into with bait fish, like in spring, with some of these rivers that I'm fishing here that connect to Lake Michigan and have our migratory fish, we tend to have a lot of juvenile, migratory fish heading out in spring. So at that time, you know, white kind of becomes small to medium sized white. Even, you know, if there's a lot of steelhead par, bigger white patterns, and that tends to kind of rule the roll the day. Fall, we don't really have a lot of that going on. And typically, you know, if I'm looking, hunting for bigger fish, I'm scaling up to a little bigger flies, you know, and my typical rotation, you know, over the years, you know, white's always good. Yellow for browns is always a great standard. Olive, really dirty water, black seems to fish well. I mean, those are kind of the four in the rotation. And, you know, most of the time my flies, like for fall, you know, fishing some of this stuff, I'm fishing, you know, 4 to 6 inch long flies. Okay. You know, I know there's guys running 8-10 inch flies, but I find those to be pretty hard to cast for an 8 hour day.
Right.
You know, when you're scaling up to 8 weights and, you know, something a little more comfortable to cast, but it's big enough to get, you know, be motivation for a large fish to come out and eat it. So.
Sure.
You know, but I think that's good. But like I said, in spring, there's times where, you know, the big fish are keyed in on, you know, 2-inch, 3-inch long bait fish, and even sometimes 1 or 2 inch, you know, long ones. And then you have to scale way down and you're getting those really big fish eating those smaller patterns too. So.
Okay.
Yeah. So
good info. So. Let's segue into smallmouth fishing and,
sure.
and something that I'd like to start with that you and I were talking about the other day that I've really only, started to think about recently is, smallmouth are really a migratory fish as well. And I personally haven't given it a ton of thought over the years. And I don't think most people think of them as really a migratory fish, but they do move around in the river systems. Could you kind of maybe from, you know, spring to fall through winter, where are you typically finding these fish throughout the year?
So what I tend to see with our fish, if we're going to start kind of in spring, anywhere where we have access, like I fish the big Manatee predominantly for my smallmouth fishery. So that fishery, we typically don't see many smallmouth entering the system till about the middle of May. And that kind of coincides with when we lose once our steelhead basically exit the river and our steelhead numbers are dwindling to down, our smallmouth tend to enter the river. And we start seeing that kind of build up about, I would say, mid-May on. And okay. So those fish are coming out of Manistee Lake, Lake Michigan, where they're, you know, those fish are wintering over in those still waters. I think they have fairly easy access to it, and it just gives them a much better, probably survivability, food sources, you know, less work, they're out of the current. They can suspend in a lake, you know, they can definitely, you know, it's much easier for them to live. I mean, some rivers, I think that don't have that access to those still waters that I've fished in the past have, you know, typically they're going to hold into a deeper, calmer, slower section of river. You know, something that's going to cause them a little, they're not going to burn as many calories. They can kind of slow down. But our fish tend to up here, you know, for the most part, tend to do a lot of that migration. And we'll see those fish, you know, come in that time frame in mid-May. And then as our steelhead build in, like, say, the Manistee here too, you know, this time of year as we're getting to late September into early October, when those steelhead are showing up, our smallmouth are heading out and they're, like I said, dropping into the Manistee Lake, Lake Michigan. And I think this kind of, that thing happens in a lot of these rivers where they have, access to these big bodies of water that they can still water that they can drop into and winter over in and then migrate back into these river systems through the spring, summer, and early fall timetables.
Okay, so, what if you had to give a time frame for like the very best time, if you could only pick like a couple weeks to go smallmouth fishing on the rivers, when would you say the prime time is?
You know, it is, it's kind of hard to say. It's kind of weather dependent. I mean, I find, you know, I find some really good smallmouth fishing really from early June right into, you know, maybe the end of September timeframe, like right about now. You know, that it, you know, it often depends greatly on what the, you know, the water temp, water levels have been. You know, some years there seem to be a little bit more, more of a fish migration. And other years there's not as much. And, in some years, I think some of the fish even drop out of the system as the, you know, sometimes as the summer progresses, if something's not quite to their liking, they leave, they move around. So, you know, as far as, you know, the fishing is typically pretty steady though through the whole summer month. But, you know, they're typically pretty happy when that, you know, that water temps, you know, starts creeping to those 60s, and, you know, we have those low 70s through most of the summer, and, you know, the fish seem pretty happy, and, you know, most days you go out, you're gonna find some fish. So, you know, so it really varies. I've had some, you know, some fabulous fishing, you know, May through September, every month of that window. You know, it's a little different. I mean, I guess as it gets, you know, early season, it's a little more of a subsurface, you know, when the water's colder, you know, the fish are moving a little slower as the water temp moves up, you know, the fish can get a little more aggressive and, a little more anxious to chase stuff down and move a little more, and you can speed things up and not have to fish quite as deep. And, I think it kind of depends on what your favorite type of fishing is, how you want to fish for them. You know, my seasons start off typically, you know, in May, and I'm fishing a lot more still water in May and fishing 8 to 10 feet deep on intermediate line and, you know, maybe sink tips if I have to, and weighted flies. And then as it gets as the temperature starts warming up, you know, getting to the upper 50s, breaking 60, you know, I'm starting to look at throwing more top water and you know, not having to fish with, sink tips at all. And, you know, even in the river, as it gets warmer, I seldom fish sink tips. It's typically floating lines or, intermediate lines. So.
Okay. So generally you're not fishing all that deep then, or is it just that the fish will come up and feed in the upper water column, even if it is, you know, fairly deep?
The fish will often come up and feed. You know, there are occasions where they will get a little, you know, neutral or a little sour and not really be very aggressive, and you might have to get down a little deeper for them. But most days, I think, you know, you can target fish. If you're getting a fly down and, maybe 4 or 5 feet of water all the way to the surface, it, you know, it kind of depends on the mood. If I've got two guys in the boat and I'm uncertain of what they're going to be doing, I will typically run a guy in the front of the boat with a floating line and something on the surface. And then I'll run a guy in the back of the boat with a, you know, like an intermediate and a, you know, 9 foot leader with a, you know, maybe a weighted fly on there where I'm getting down to that 5 foot range. Mm-hmm. and kind of see from there what the fish want to do. Some days they're happy to eat anywhere in there. Other days they might, you know, be really focused on the surface, or other days you can't get them up on the top and they want to eat, you know, in a little bit deeper water. So there's days I let the fish tell me what they want to do, you know, and there's, you know, some days you think, oh, it'd be great as a top water day, and you get out there, fish don't want anything to do with it. You go down below, you know, underneath the surface, and the fish are coming. So,
yeah.
But typically, yeah. So.
I've noticed, you know, smallmouth in general, I wouldn't say are a picky fish. They're easy to catch and they're a ton of fun to catch. But there are days, yep, where, you know, I grew up using conventional spinning gear for smallmouth, and some days, you know, they only wanted to bite a spinner, and then some days they wouldn't, yep, bite a spinner at all, and they only wanted to bite Rapalas or Rapala with a specific retrieve. So it can be tough. They're definitely, you know, keyed in on something, much like trout will, that's causing them to only want one type of food. And then you have other days where it's like, man, you can throw anything in the water and they'll eat it.
Exactly. I mean, yeah, so there are moments, you know, like you were kind of alluding to there with, you know, there are match the hatch moments with smallmouth where there's a particular thing they're feeding on and you know, that's all they want to eat. I've had summers where we had good hopper years where, the fish get just locked in on grasshoppers, and it's like fishing for trout. You know, you're throwing into seams off banks, flopping it down there, giving it a mend, give it a little twitch, and you know, and they're eating hoppers, just coming up and crushing them. And you know, there's other days where they're focused on maybe a minnow bite. And you know, that's all they want. They want something that's going to imitate that. And they sometimes get, you know, they want it that exact size, that exact color. And there's other days where, you know, you'll hook one on a minnow patter and you'll pick him up out of the water and he'll have crayfish hanging out of his throat. And you know, and that fish is, you know, obviously open to eating whatever happens to come in front of it that day. And that those are the days you hope for, because that's typically going to be a good fishing day. The fish are happy and chasing stuff. So
yeah.
So
you're talking about gear a little bit. What types of rods and lines are you generally using for smallmouth?
So my typical smallmouth gear is going to range anywhere from like a 6 to 8 weight rod. And some of that will depend on the fish and what I'm throwing. You know, sink tip lines for deeper presentations. 90% of the time I'm typically throwing an intermediate line or throwing a floating line. So I'm typically throwing, you know, floating lines, aggressive stuff. Like I'm running the, airflow, that bass musky line. And then, you know, the beach intermediates from airflow I've been running, you know, which have worked great. You know, so the floating lines and intermediates are both probably my favorite to cast. Mm-hmm. You know, they're comfortable. There's so many great new lines. There are a lot of great lines out there, but that covers the majority of your needs. I mean, if you think you're going to throw bigger stuff or heavy weighted flies, you know, 8 weight, you know, seems like overkill, but it certainly throws some of that bigger stuff easier, and you know, still a bigger bass are gonna, you know, put a pretty good fight in it in an 8 weight. So
yeah. You know, so, but to piggyback off your comment about line, mm-hmm. I really didn't realize until this year. I've been kind of fly fishing, you know, most of my life, but really didn't start taking it more seriously until the last couple of years. And man, line is such an important factor in being good at fly fishing. I've realized I've finally spent the money and paid for some good fly line, and it just makes an absolute world of difference over, you know, $30 line that you got at Walmart.
Absolutely night and day. I mean, I remember when I first started, you know, fishing, and you know, I had some, you know, inexpensive, you know, kind of just picked it up, you know, it would not cast well, you know, and I thought, you know, a lot of it's, man, I must really be bad at this. This is frustrating. And, yeah. And I would get people even now with the boat that, oh, I picked this up from this and this. And I, you know, I was, you know, I just can't seem to cast it very well. And you pick it up and it's like, here, try, you know, try this rod and try this line, or here, let me put one of my reels on this rod. And you know, and they're like, oh my gosh, I can cast, I can feel it. And you know, that's probably in all the things since I've been fly fishing, you know, that the advancement in lines, and it's amazing the difference a line can make to your casting, to what a rod feels like. I always tell everybody, if you've got a shop near you, somebody that has, you know, a bunch of different lines, and you have a rod, you know, put a bunch of different lines on it, see how it feels, how it casts. I mean, it's night and day.
Yeah.
You know, with that stuff.
Yeah, so, absolutely. And not that I'm telling you anything that you don't know here, but in case, you know, people listening are planning to buy some fly fishing stuff, go to your local shops and ask questions, because they probably have a good idea for what rod pairs well with what line already, as opposed to buying it off Amazon and saving $5 or $10 and then realizing it's not the right line and you got to go out and buy line all over again. You know, yep. If for anybody listening, use the people in the shops as a resource. That's what they're there for, and there to help. I'm in Grand Rapids here, so the guys at Nomad have helped me out a couple times this summer, and recommended lines and worked out perfectly. And that's something you don't get on the online stores.
No. And, you know, and most of those guys that are, you know, in fly shops or guides that, you know, or, you know, if you can, that fish for the species you're intending to fish for, you know, ask those questions and it, you know, they've probably had a bunch of stuff that hasn't worked out very well and found particular lines that work very well for the situations. And the amount of difference of enjoyment, if you have a line that's going to cast and do what you want it to do when you're out there compared to a line that's, well, I saved 20, like you said, I saved 20 bucks on it. And, you know, what's 20 bucks in the course of, you know, 10 years you're going to fish the fly line and you're struggling with it when you could have a line for 20 bucks more that, you know, does what you want. It does it well and makes, and I mean, nothing makes me smile or makes me happier when I see people fishing well or I'm fishing well and putting cast where I want them to go. And it just feels good. I mean,
yeah.
So that to get those prop, those rods and lines, you know, and the line, like you said, I'm 100% agreement. The line is massively important. I would say out of everything you do with your fly fishing, it's the absolutely the most important piece between, you know, rods, reels, line. Line's probably the most important thing in the bunch.
Yeah. Yeah. I would agree. Cause I mean, I've got one rod. I won't name names cause I don't want to bash anybody, but it's a fairly inexpensive rod. And I knew that when I bought it several years back and I needed something a little bit heavier for steelhead fishing. And the rod just doesn't cast well, but when I put new line on there, it was like a completely different rod. It's still not great. I still have rods that cast better, but the significant improvement of just putting a good line on a reel and then slapping it on a mediocre rod was shocking. Yeah. Actually, yep. Now I use that for my mousing rod because I'm not casting very far and I just gotta.
Yep. Yeah, and you can do some, you know, and you can do it, you know, with lines. I mean, there are times that, you know, a rod, you know, if you've got a rod that's crazy fast, you know, and that seems to be a trend. Or was a trend. It seems like it's coming back to more realistic, you know, rod actions. And but you know, we had the trend of these super super fast rods, and the normal fishing situations you're put in, and normal people casting them, they didn't cast well, you know. So you know, you find, you know, some of that, you know, they have those rods that don't cast well, and you know, they bump up a line, you know, you bump up a line size or so on the rod. And, you know, and that rod flexes a little more and it actually makes the rod feel a little slower than what it did. And it sometimes, you know, that makes a lot of difference with, you know, somebody casting. So sometimes even these manufacturers, you know, most of them are pretty close, but, you know, there's normally a little wiggle room even on what line weight you're putting on there. I mean, most of the time it's going to be your, you know, if you got a 5-weight, it's going to be a 5-weight line, but there's occasions where, you know, that rod casts better with maybe a 6-weight line on it.
Yep.
So, or yeah. or a more aggressive line for that matter, you know. So.
Yeah, and much of that is still over my head. That's why, like I said, I lean on people that are doing it more often and live and breathe and work in the industry to sure. Help me out. let's talk about some of your favorite flies. What types of flies, if you could name like your top three or five or however many you can think of that you're using on a day-to-day basis or week-to-week basis?
Yeah, for my smallmouth stuff, I, you know, the probably my favorite flies, easy to tie, super durable, you know, a gurgler pattern, you know, and probably fishing it in a size 2 or 4. You know, white chartreuse, kind of a frog green, you know, those, that would be, you know, for topwater stuff that, you know, for simplicity, I think the fish hold onto it because it's soft, you know, it kind of has a little bit more of a lifelike feel. Mm-hmm. And you can push water with it. And you can cut the front lip off and turn it into a slider if you want. So that's a really versatile, really, you know, if you're tying your own flies, it's an easy fly to tie. You know, for hard bodied topwater stuff like Google bugs are fabulous, you know, patterns. you know, for durability, and they make a lot of noise when they come, you know, come through the water, and you have massive color choices and size choices in them. You know, so those are probably my two top, you know, top water baits or flies. For subsurface stuff, the, you know, Clouser minnow is, really, really hard one to beat. It's a, you know, great minnow imitator. You can tie it in multiple sizes. You can add flash. You can fish it with the basic bucktail scenario. You know, you can go heavy lead eyes. You can go bead chain eyes. So you can change that. You know, the biggest thing with that fly is it really requires, you to move the fly. You know, okay. Some of the, so your stripping sometimes with that is a little more, you know, you have to really concentrate a little bit more on that. Some of the flies that have, marabou, more feathers, something that, that tends to move in current or move in the water, or if it just, or if you barely twitch it, you can see it undulate. Some of the, I guess those flies, I always think of flies that have movement without you having to move them.
Yeah.
You know, so flies like that, I mean, I have a few patterns of my own that I tie that really, really aren't named for, you know, stuff on the, you know, market out there for flies. You know, a really simple fly for smallies that I like. I'm trying to think of the Western trout fly. It's basically, rust and yellow, cone head with rubber legs and rust and yellow marabou tail. So it's kind of like a J&J special, I think is what they call that. And so a fly similar to that worked really well. That rubber leg, kicking like that, works well. You know, a lot of your trout streamers double, well as, you know, smallmouth patterns. The Conrad Sculpin is one of my favorite articulated trout streamers, and that fly works very well for smallies too. That's another one that's got a lot of, got marabou feathers, you know, it you know, deer hair head, it kicks, it moves, you know, that kind of can draw some serious attention. You know, another Michigan pattern, a Murdich minnow, that, you know, with that flash, suspends nice. I mean, that's another good quality, you know, when you can find multiple places, it's a good smallmouth getter. So,
okay.
But that kind of give you, that would be kind of a general box. And you know, if you were fishing still water, where you don't have a lot of current, you know, crayfish patterns, you know, near enough crayfish, something like that is a good pattern for that. But you can really do a lot in with cone head rubber leg buggers. You can change to large sizes, small sizes, and imitate a lot of different things with those too. If you're tying your own, you know, it doesn't have to be anything particularly fancy.
Gotcha. So we were talking earlier about kind of the areas you find them in seams, and do you generally find smallmouth in a lot of the same areas that you would find trout, and could you kind of describe where those areas are?
So, you know, I typically, when I'm thinking smallmouth, I mean, I get smallies out of quick water at times, but I tend to think of them, you know, they like current, but typically not heavy, heavy current. Mm-hmm. So, or at least where I'm finding them, you know, I find them on inside edges of current, you know, some of the slower water areas, you know, and if you get real high water events, definitely look to the slowest water you can possibly find. They typically try to get out of that big current and get the soft water where it's a little bit easier for them to sit and hunt. So, right. You know, I'm looking for those, current changes, but not necessarily the fast sides of the current changes. I'm typically seeing them coming out of the slower part of those current changes, if that makes sense.
Yeah. So do you think they're, they're maybe like sitting on the edges of the current waiting for something to flow by, some food to go by, and they're going out and snatching it and then getting back into that slow current.
Exactly. It's a little easier for them to sit and live in those areas. And I think some of those, you know, those edges, you know, especially if they're shoreline edges, you know, that gives the fish opportunity for food, you know, minnows, crayfish, things coming down through there. And then, you know, if it's near the edges of the shore, you can have whatever happens to tumble into the river, being it, you know, later in the year, hoppers, frogs early on in the season, you know, so, you know, they definitely can be opportunistic feeders, mm-hmm. but they're also going to try to limit their, you know, calories, you know, they're burning tons of calories trying to hold in super fast water and feed, you know, they're not built quite as aerodynamic as what a trout would be, where they can sit in that fast water and find the slightest little
pocket out of
the current. So, you know, they're a little thicker, a little heavier, a little more blunt, you know, so I don't think their ability to tuck into like that really fast, heavy current is as good. So they kind of move to those edges or where there's bigger current breaks anyway.
Right. Yeah, that makes sense. And I would agree with you. The one thing though about smallmouth that I've found is, like, generally, yeah, they're not in that super fast water, but there are days when they are. And I'm thinking back to a time where I was fishing with my cousin Dustin on the Grand, and there is a section that we float that has some pretty fast water, like very fast water, where normally you wouldn't find them sitting in there. And
right,
we, you know, it's actually like a blown out dam. So there's a dam in one side of it's blown out. It's not a real big dam, but it creates, you know, a very fast channel of water that comes ripping through one side. And man, one day we went up there and we're chucking into that fast water, and we were throwing Texas rig rubber crayfish and just kind of like bouncing them along the bottom, almost swinging them like streamer fishing, like you'd swing streamers. And we caught just a ton of fish out of that really fast water and a bunch of really nice ones. And I mean, as far as like current goes, it's about as fast of a current as you're going to find in the state of Michigan. But ever since then, you know, we always stop there and fish though. We'll kayak it and we'll get out and fish there. But we really have never seen that again. And I'm always wondering, like, what was it? There had to have been something going on in there, some type of food source, that they were all up in that crazy fast water. It was strange. So it's like when I'm smallmouth fishing, I kind of start my day off like casting to all kinds of different areas. And then generally I'll find like they're in the really slow water, or maybe they're above the riffles, or, you know, it always seems to be a little bit different. And I can never put my finger on why, because the days we're fishing are, you know, nice sunny summer days that sun's out and everything seems to be about the same temperature. River temp's probably close to the same, but for whatever reason, I can't figure it out. And in the Grand, at least, I find them in different spots.
I think you could, you know, like say you had that fast water, you know, you could have had some food drifting through there even. And, you know, that was creating a pretty nice food funnel. And, you know, those fish have, you know, there were fish food tearing through there and they could sit in there. And it was, you know, there was enough food coming through that it was worth the expenditure of energy to sit in that and feed if they could get enough food. You know, with the fish in different spots, I mean, I find that here, you know, like our fish with, like I said, the migratory nature of these fish sometimes, I mean, you might find fish in the same spot for 5 days, 6 days, and then all of a sudden they're not there anymore. And then another spot that, you know, you fish for years and years and years that does produce, you hadn't produced for, you know, a while. And then all of a sudden you go through there and it's piled with fish. You know, so I think sometimes it might be just their movement. You know, if you have a group of fish moving into areas, or they're moving, you know, due to maybe water temperature, water levels, you know, I mean, you could even see that faster water. If, you know, they, if you're going to definitely have more oxygen in that. So maybe that was could even been an oxygen related issue too.
Yeah, true. I didn't think of that because compared to the Manistee, the Grand is much slower and dirtier and probably has less oxygen.
Right. So, you know, there could have been some goofy thing where that really drew them to that. Or like I said, it could have just been one of those food things. I mean, they're certainly a strong enough fish to fit, to move through current and sit in current. But I just think in most days they tend to, you know, for the most part, not be in the heaviest of the flows in the river. So.
Right.
But
the things that fish do that we'll never know why, but, you know, that's why you fish a lot and find all those good spots, because one day they're there and one day they're not.
Yep, I always laugh. You know, everybody's like, I got it all figured out. And, you know, and it feels like sometimes for, you know, a week or two, you've got it patterned and everything's working pretty well. And then one day there, you don't see, like you said, you don't see any significant change in the water, the temperatures, anything. And all of a sudden, wherever they were, whatever you were doing, is not working like it was. And then you've got to kind of rethink and reset and you know, try something new and concentrate on some different water and different techniques and see what produces. But it's always strange. I mean, it's, as they call it, say it's fishing, not catching. So some days they're, you know, committing suicide and coming at you, and other days they're there. Sometimes you can see them. You can throw everything you want at them. You can fish on the surface. You can drag it across the bottom. You can, you know, practically hit them with it, and they have nothing to do with it. They don't want to eat. They don't want to feed. They're just not happening.
Yep. So, luckily, there aren't too many of those days with smallmouth, which is why I like to target them, though.
You typically, even a slow day with them, you're going to find some fish, you know, where a lot of these species, you know, slow day trout fishing or slow day fishing migratory fish, that typically is going to mean you might not get a bite or see a fish all day long. So.
Yeah, I've had, you know, especially steelhead. I mean, I've definitely had more days where I have not caught a fish than where I have caught fish. And trout, it's not completely unheard of to go out and not catch something, but.
Yeah. You know, in smallmouth, it's typically, if you put a full day in smallmouth fishing, it's, you know, especially during the main parts of the season, it would be pretty rare to come back without a fish, you know, or not caught a fish, you know, it's pretty unheard of. So but it happens once in a while.
Yes, it, I'm sure it does. If you're out there enough, it's bound to. So, what is a really good day of smallmouth fishing on the river look like number wise up there on the Manistee?
So the Manistee, I would say, is not, it's not one of the higher number fisheries in the state. I mean, there's rivers that are putting up some pretty good numbers. You know, Manistee, if you land, you know, double digit fish, you're having a good day. You know, I've had days where you're landing, you know, 20, 30 fish. You know, that's exceptional. Mm-hmm. You know, the one thing we do, I mean, we have good quality fish. I mean, I would say the average fish in the Manistee is probably 14 or 15 inches long.
Oh, okay.
And, you know, most days you've got, you know, a shot at, you know, something in the upper teens, you know, so, you know, those opportunities are there. So I would say it's more of a quality versus quantity fishery. Mm-hmm. You know, now the Stillwater, when I'm fishing some of that stuff in May, you know, that can be kind of the one where it's a little different. I mean, that you could legit have a, you know, 30, 40 fish day, you know, if things are going right, and, you know, and then mix in, you know, many other species. You know, you have a few pike in there, you'd have rock bass, you might have beluga, you might have crappie. So, I mean, you could have, you know, you're going to have some pretty good action throughout the day. And, you know, and so then you're kind of just mixing in all those different species, but, you know, smallmouth wise, you're going to have some decent numbers.
So. Yeah. You ever see those, you know, big old 5-pound lake smallies come swimming up in the river?
You know, I see some on occasion. Every, you know, I do not get as, you know, I typically, if it's close to 20, I typically try to check and make sure to keep myself honest, because sometimes those 19 inch fish look, you know, when you pull put them in the net, they look like, man, that's a 20. And then you measure, it's like 18 and a half, it's 19.
Yeah.
But you know, we'll see some 20 inch fish, you know, some, you know, and I think the biggest out of the manatee that I've gotten with anybody is like 22 and a half.
Which is a great fish. But
yeah, I mean, I've seen some fish that were probably those 6-7 pound range fish. I just can't ever get one to eat anything or get it to the net in the river. They, you know, I've had them chased. I've had a couple of them hooked, but they're pretty few and far between, you know. Yeah. 20 inch fish, you know, is certainly within the realm of possibility. But, you know, once they start breaking, getting much over 20, they're get fewer and fewer of them. So.
Okay. And for people listening that might not have a lot of river smallmouth or not aware of the difference, you know, the smallmouth that you see that are the monsters are generally caught out in the lakes, Lake St. Clair, the Great Lakes, or even inland lakes. Whereas river smallmouth, I mean, a 5 pound river smallmouth is an absolute monster. I mean,
it's a monster for sure.
You rarely are ever going to see that. I've never seen anything close to that fishing for smallmouth in my days on a river, honestly. Now, if you go down and fish, is it Manistee Lake? Is that
what? Manistee Lake, yeah.
Okay. Now, if you go out and fish in the lake out there, do people catch, you know, the great big giant ones in the still water out there?
They get some big fish in there, but it still doesn't seem to be of the quality of, say, you know, like some of those fish they get up in Traverse Bay and some of those bigger inland lakes up there. They seem to, for whatever reason, you know, Traverse Bay, you know, with Lake Michigan, and then, like, you know, you've got some of the like Lake Charlevoix and all those lakes up in there that seem to produce some just absolutely gigantic fish. But I'm sure the possibilities are there, but I just don't hear about nor see a lot of fish of that size class coming out of Manistee Lake.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm sure there's got to be some there, but it seems like, you know, some of those bigger, clearer lakes seem to have much larger smallmouth on average in them. You know, for us in the river, I typically tell the guys it's like a brown trout. You know, it's, you know, if it, you know, 20 inches is a trophy fish. I mean, if you get a 20 incher, that's a lot of fish, and you know, that's not a everyday, nor does everyone ever catch a 20 inch, you know, smallmouth or trout for that matter. So
I what's a master angler? I think 21.
I think so. Yep.
Yeah, because whatever, I caught one out of the Grand one time, and it was by far my biggest. That was 20, just a hair over 20. But the Grand, I mean, I would not say the average size is anywhere close to 14. I would say average size fish in the Grand is probably 8 to maybe 12 inches, and you catch
probably
a ton of those. Yeah.
Yep.
You catch tons and tons of them on the right day. I've had days where I go out and you catch three fish in a full day of fishing too. So, I'll have to get up there and do some fishing on the Manistee in the summer.
I'd love to get you up here and fish with me.
Yeah. Yeah. That'd be great. One of my buddies did go up there and camped, and he said they caught some really nice smallmouth up there this summer. So it's a great break for if you are a trout fisherman. In the summertime to do something a little bit different when it's hot. And
it's, I typically, like, if I have multiple bait, you know, trips, which, you know, is fairly frequent to have 2 or 3 days, and, you know, it's nice. I typically, you know, then, you know, if it's July and August type of trips, you know, mix in some smallmouth fishing, do a day trout fishing on the pine, and kind of do a little bit of both. And that really makes for, you know, it's fun. And if you're up here doing it on your own, I mean, that certainly you can, you know, canoe the pine or walk in on the pine. And then, you know, if you have a boat, you can fish the big river for smallies. And, it's a nice mix for sure.
Yeah. And even if you don't catch any fish on the pine's just such a beautiful river to be on that it's worth going there just to see it.
It is absolutely amazing. It's one of those treasures. I always tell everybody, if you've got a bucket list trout, river, or it should be on your bucket list for Michigan for sure, with the high gradient, the cold water temps, and there's not many rivers. You can get a wild rainbow, wild brown trout, and a wild brook trout all on the same day. So
yeah, and those are truly wild fish, correct? They don't plant in there anymore.
So they haven't planted since the mid 70s, I think 76 on the pine. So
that's crazy.
So those fish are many generations in, naturalized population of fish. So
yeah, because there's, very, very few rivers that, if they stopped planting them in Michigan, there would probably still be trout there for a long time. But eventually, there'd probably be some type of, something that happened that they would die off eventually, especially down here in southern Michigan, either whether the water's too warm or there's a pollution event or, something. But
yeah,
I didn't know that it had been that long since the 70s.
Yeah, I think from what I understood and read on that, there were, they had a budget crunch there in the mid 70s, the state, and they, some of the rivers they had traditionally stocked, that during that time they just quit stocking them. And then when they had the ability to do it again, a few of these rivers had just, the populations had naturalized and were reproducing well. And, there was really no reason to come back in and stock them. The little manatee was the same way with brown trout. They quit about the same time there. And, that river's got doesn't have tons and tons of, fish, but I shouldn't say not lots of quantity, but the quality. It's one of the better big trout streams for small water that, we have. So, and they seem to do, they've done very well in there. So,
yeah, trout are crazy species too. The places that you'll find them, sometimes you look at a river and you think it's not worth fishing, and then it looks like a drainage, and then that turns out to be a place, for whatever reason, they're naturally reproducing in there.
Yeah, there's something there. They're getting cold enough and enough oxygen that they do well in it. I know some of the, there's some of those little streams, down in southern Michigan that, and they run through farm fields, and you'd think there, there'd be nothing in them, and they actually have decent populations of trout in them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've found a couple of those over the years. They're few and far between, especially once you get south of, like, say, Grand Rapids, or especially Kalamazoo.
Right.
They're very tough to find, but they're out there. You've got to spend some time looking for them, and that's all part of the adventure, in my opinion.
It is, for sure. For sure.
Well, on the smallmouth front, is there anything else that you could throw out there for the listeners, maybe that we don't know, or just some good tips?
As far as smallmouth fishing, we covered some good stuff earlier, as far as, I would, vary up what you're doing a little bit. Probably the one thing I always find interesting for me, I find people give up on, like, the topwater fishing quickly, through the course of a day. They, for whatever reason, they think that's going to be the least productive method. And I can honestly say for myself, in my guiding, I have probably caught more big smallmouth on the surface than I've caught subsurface.
Really?
But I tend to stick to it quite maybe longer than I would think I should, at times. But, I often wonder, a lot of those fish, we don't get tons of pressure up here, but, places that there is a little bit more pressure, or the fish have been pressured, they see a lot of subsurface presentation.
Mm-hmm.
and sometimes, that top water, they don't see it as often, and it sits there. If they're in a little more neutral mood, they can, they can look at it, and you twitch it a little bit and fish it, kind of slow, and those, I think some of those bigger fish are a little more susceptible to it. And the one thing with that technique, I typically fish, most of the time when I get somebody to boat, they throw a popper out, and it's just chug, 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 as hard as they can, just ripping it through the water. And typically I tell myself, okay, we'll try that later if we're not getting anything, but let's start off. Let's throw it up there, throw a mend in it, let it flow a little bit, give it just a little twitch. So it just moves the water, holds the legs back on it, let it sit for a few seconds, and then another small twitch, and then kind of let it swing across. And I think sometimes with that top water in a very, very subtle presentation, almost like for the trout guys, you know, they could probably relate it to throwing a grasshopper out there or throwing a big stonefly pattern out there. We kind of want it dead drifting almost, but then twitching every once in a while to give it a kind of an illusion that it's alive. Mm-hmm. And I think that's one of those things that I see up people's catch rate on smallmouth is doing going to top water and then going to a much more subtle presentation with top water instead of that really hard, flashy, jerky retrieve. Now that being said, if it's over deeper water and the fish are, you know, there are moods where they want that, but I'd say 90% of the time I'm fishing that slow, easy presentation. And probably the other thing that I do a lot of, especially early in the season when I'm fishing still water, I fish a lot of intermediate lines with long 9-10 foot leaders down to like 8 pound fluoro, and then weighted like clousers or any fly that's going to drop in the water, count fast and you know, count those down and really look at, instead of just throwing them out there and just immediately stripping them back, you know, counting them down to where I think I'm getting into those, you know, 8-10 foot edges, things like that. So, you know, and then with that, a really, really slow retrieve, you know, sometimes it's a little 2-inch at a time retrieve where those fish are kind of neutral. You got pre-spawn fish, you know, and that's one of those times of year too, when you really got a great shot at hooking one of those truly large fish, when you do have shots of big female fish, you know, and that can be, you know, real.
Uh-oh, lost him again. We're going to have to call John right back.
Sorry, I lost you there again. My weather kind of went a little haywire here again.
No worries.
So just I think I dropped you there with you just talking about some of that early season and the real slow retrieves and intermediate lines, long leaders.
Yep.
You know, and those are two. Yeah, I mean, those are two kind of the opposite, the two most opposite things I do for smallmouth fishing, but those are two of the, you know, more effective, you know, presentations for times of year that I, you know, get some of my better and bigger fish on.
Yeah. And that actually reminds me of a question I wanted to ask you earlier that I forgot about. And this is why I'm asking it. Generally, when I'm thinking about topwater, and I grew up doing a lot of largemouth bass fishing on lakes, topwaters work really good in the morning and really good right before dark. And I've just carried that with me through the years into smallmouth fishing. But from other people I talk to, it sounds like that's not as much of the case. What's your take on using top water throughout the day versus right in the first thing in the morning, evening? Does it make a difference?
I have no qualms using it right in the middle of the day. You know, it can certainly be effective early and late in those low light conditions, but there are times, you know, when, you know, maybe even when it's a water temp issue where the water temp's increasing during the day, the fish are getting a little more ramped up and ready to feed. And I've caught tons of nice fish, you know, right smack dab in the middle of the day on top water. So I certainly wouldn't give up throwing top water, through the whole. I mean, there are some days I'm fishing top water all day, and I've had days where I put the one popper on and it never changes all day long when the fishing's good. And it just, then that's it. I mean, you fish that top water flat all day long.
And that is about as much fun as you can have while fishing, in my opinion. Catching big smallies on top water on a fly rod, it doesn't get much better.
It is amazing. I mean, you know, we were talking big fish. I mean, the best day I've ever had, you know, maybe not numbers wise, the quality fish. I had one of my clients, just him in the boat, and this was on the Manistee, and we were fishing, you know, white gurglers, and we fished that fly all day, and he got that day five smallies over 20 inches. Our biggest one was 21 and a half, and then we got multiple fish in like 17, 18, 19 inch class. It was like the best day. I mean, it was the best day I've ever had for big fish anywhere by far. And we just, I think, hit these, you know, post-spawn females that were coming up to the river to feed. And the takes were like, you know, you would throw it out and it would hit the water and you would see a wake 20 feet away coming up the river to eat it. And when it flushed and when they'd eat it, it looked like, you know, a wash tub, you know, circle and flush from the fish taking it. And, you know, and that was like one of those top water days. And, you know, they were all over it. But, you know, I mean, that's the best day in all the years of smallmouth fish for big fish. But, you know, those days can happen. And, you know, there's plenty of days where you go out and you get, you know, mid to upper teen fish on those top water, and even seeing a 15 to 18 inch fish, you know, sometimes blow those top water flies up is impressive. And oddly, there's days where, you know, you're doing the same fly and they come up and sip it as dainty as a trout would be eating like a midge. You know, it's just that you just all of a sudden the fly is just gone, you know, and you tell the guy to set the hook and, you know, there's an 18 inch smallmouth on there. And, you know, so if, you know, that kind of goes to their mood sometimes. Sometimes they're the most aggressive fish I've ever seen in my life. And there's other times they are just thoughtful and kind of reserved, and, you know, and it there's a, you know, a lot of variance, but, you know, very fun. I mean, I know when another one of my days, and, you know, we got fish, but for how aggressive they can be, I had a guy fishing, and this wasn't a big fish, like a 12 inch fish, but we were throwing small minnow patterns, and he had this smallmouth, and it was coming straight at the boat. And, you know, the fish would eat it straight on, but never would turn. And he's like, what am I going to do? I said, just keep stripping, you know, he'll turn eventually. And, you know, the fish would eat it and he'd strip, and the fly would come straight out of the fish's mouth. And the fish did this like five times, you know, in the same cast. He just kept accelerating, really? And it'd be gone. And he's like, what am I going to do? I said, just strip it to the boat. And he got it to the boat, and he got up there and he lifted the fly out of the water, and it was dangling the foot out of the water, and the smallmouth jumped straight out of the water, grabbed the fly and hooked itself right at the boat. So it's just like, it's like, okay, now there's a fish that wants it, you know?
Yep.
But, you know, you have days like that where you weren't going to get that fly away from that fish. And there's other days, you know, they're all over and you just can't get it. I mean, you can try everything you want and they just don't want to have it. So, but that kind of keeps you coming back. Every day is different. So.
Yep. No, man, I absolutely love smallmouth. I think they're finally starting to get the credit that they deserve, because they're absolutely just a fantastic sport fish. And they fight incredibly hard, and they offer really every challenge you want in a fish. They can be hard to catch, easy to catch, big, small. I think everybody that has knocked on bass fishing, that's a big trout fisherman or salmon fisherman, like, this is not going to your local lake and catching 12 inch largemouth bass, you know, on a Cinco, one right after the other. This is a completely different game. And everybody needs to try it, in my opinion.
And I'm with you. I mean, it, you know, it was, you know, one of those things where when I started guiding, you know, particularly up here, I mean, our area is known for trout fishing and our migratory fish, and getting people to try smallmouth fishing when, you know, I knew it was really good and maybe the trout fishing wasn't going to be as good. And, you know, and it was kind of like pulling teeth initially. And then once I started getting a few people doing it, you know, they were like shocked at how much fun it was. And they couldn't believe they hadn't done it before. And, you know, now my May through September, you know, I probably do more smallmouth trips than I do trout trips anymore. And people love it. And I love it. It's fun. It's, you know, it offers, like you said, it offers anything you could possibly want for an angler. from top water to, you know, these vicious takes. Pretty places. I mean, mm-hmm. we always, you know, the old saying is trout don't live in ugly places. Well, you know, smallmouth also live in some really beautiful places too. And, you know, some of the water that I fish, you know, for smallmouth is also trout water, and they kind of co-mingle, through the summers. And, you know, I mean, like the Hoden Pile stretch of the Manistee up here, I would put that against about any float in Michigan as far as sheer beauty. And you've got all those trout-like elements, but you're fishing for smallmouth.
Right.
And, you know, in times of year when maybe you couldn't have fished trout on that stretch, but smallmouth are happy and eating and the streamer thing has caught on so well with the trout guys that, you know, that's a pretty easy transition from, you know, trout streamer fishermen to smallmouth fishermen. It's a pretty easy hop. So, you know, your rods, your flies, a lot of that stuff is going to work for both.
Yeah.
So.
Well, all right, John, I appreciate all the time that you spent sharing your years of knowledge with us. I'll definitely, you know, I'd love to get up there and fish with you sometime. So I'll be hitting you up next spring, early summer to figure out when we're going to do that. Hey, real quick though, before I let you go, you gotta let people know how they can find you if they want to book a trip.
Yeah, so if you would like to book a trip, I have a website. It's GoukerFlyFishing.com. That would be probably the easiest, and that's got my contact, my phone, and everything on it, and my email. So that'd be the easiest thing. So it's GoukerFlyFishing.com. So.
Okay, and how's that yeah. spelled for anybody that might not find it?
It's Gouker is my last name. Not many Goukers around, so yeah, it's hard to.
Yeah.
don't really know the spelling when you don't probably have never met a Gouker. So
yeah, I think you're the only one that I've run across so far. Not a lot of DeKaisers run around either, though.
That is true.
All right. Well, appreciate it, John. Thanks so much for sharing all your knowledge, and have a great night.
Yeah, I appreciate you having me on.
No problem.
Thanks a lot.
Bye.
Bye.